Well, folks, Talon has asked me to kind of give a follow-up to our little meeting here a few weeks ago with the historical group. And we're going to kind of do just a quick little walkthrough and take a look at some of the items in the firehouse. People were inquiring about that night, maybe didn't get enough time to, you know, get to all the questions and whatnot. Needless to say, I think probably the biggest question would be about the fire engines themselves. So I can give you a quick rundown on what we have here and maybe a little history on each truck, just a short history on each one. The first one you're looking at right here, the Talon's focusing in on right now, this is a 1922 American LaFrance. American LaFrance was a company that was started in 1845 in Elmira, New York. They built fire engines up until last year, and they went out of business. But this particular engine right here was built in 1922 and bought by the city of Granite City. This was actually the first fire engine that the fire department acquired when they when it became a paid fire department in 1922. Some of you probably heard before the history of this truck. In 1928 it was rolled over. There was a fatality. The assistant chief was killed in that accident. The truck was sent back to the factory, rebuilt, and it lived here in Granite City until 1964. At that time, it went to Illinois State University, became a pep rally truck. I found it in 1987 in bushel baskets, and my father and I restored it. It took us about 4.5 years, and we finished it up in October of 1991. So it actually rests right now, it's sitting right now, and it's the original spot that it was parked in the day it was delivered here in 1922. So it is an operational pumper, runs, pumps, does everything it's supposed to. Doesn't see much fire anymore, but a lot of people get a kick out of looking at it. It's got a lot of personality to it, with the gold leafing and lettering and whatnot. Just to kind of sidetrack a little bit, if you want to go to the rear of the truck for just a second.
Yeah.
I'm just going to give you a little corner shot here on the wall on Talon's here. I was going to just kind of give you an example of...
Here. Yeah, you might want to come back a little bit for that.
That's all right. That's all right.
I was doing a roundabout. a lot of people ask what that is up there with the bullseye in the middle of it, and that is... That's a life net. They were employed for years and years by fire departments as a life-saving device for people that were on multi-story buildings. If they had the guts to jump into it, it was there was a possibility that maybe they could survive. It's kind of deceiving looking. It's very heavy and usually was actually deployed with 10 men surrounding it in order to hold the thing up and make it functional if somebody were to jump into it. A friend of mine hung that up there one day when I was not here, and how in the devil he got it up there, I can't tell you, but it's up there, and I'm not going to try to move it at this point. Some other things that I have here in the firehouse, this is an old chemical wagon. They used a lot of these small village departments and whatnot back at the turn of the last century would use this for fire protection. Not very functional, you know, in this day and age, naturally. They were also used quite a bit by industrial locales, factories, railroad yards, things like that, places where they needed pretty instant fire protection, but maybe they didn't own a fire engine. Couple of the other things back here, the board that you see back there is actually a basically a manning board, and it is a call board. It came from the East St. Louis Fire Department. It hung in their
one of their engine houses. They're actually their central headquarters engine house for years and years and years, and it found its way here. They were going to trash it, so that's how it ended up in this building. So then you see a lot of tidbits here, just odds and ends, bits and pieces. People that have given me over the years, or that I've collected over the years, parts for my trucks. Pretty much just kind of a grab bag of whatever you can think of back here for the antique fire apparatus. And for anybody's interest, you know, in this subject or in this hobby. So
nice. I know. I remember you telling the story of Charbonnier and the wreck.
Charbonnier?
Might be a morbid question. Is that the bell?
I can't be for certain that is the bell, but that is the bell that was on this truck after 1928. I'm positive of that. Okay. I know where the bell came from, so I know that is the bell from this particular truck. It could be that it is the bell because the eagle is what pierced Chief Charbonnier's heart. And the eagle, as you can see, is held on by four screws. So it very well could have been that, you know, there was damage to that and the eagle was replaced. But to answer your question as to whether that is the exact bell, my guess is that it's probably the second bell this truck had.
Yeah.
Because the truck was heavily damaged, and I would imagine the bell was too. Talon's taking a little view of the cockpit here.
Yeah.
It's not really too hard to figure out once you jump in there, but a lot of people are perplexed by the location of the steering wheel. And reason being for that is that these trucks came along shortly after gasoline-powered fire apparatus, or vehicles for that matter, were put on the road. Your early wagons, your buckboard wagons, stagecoaches, vehicles such as that, the driver sat on the right side of the vehicle. That's where the brake handle is, which is what that handle is that you see sticking up right there. That's the gear shift, actually. Emergency brakes right next to it. Mm-hmm. So when they first started manufacturing these type vehicles, they automatically put the driver's controls and the steering wheel on that side of the truck, which they changed in the late 20s, and they moved them over to the conventional side as we know them now. So a lot of people are kind of they're not real sure of that when they get on the truck. It's unusual, but once you get on there and drive it, it's there's nothing to it. There's nothing any different. You just actually you're able to keep from hitting the curb better. So the truck itself has got a six-cylinder motor in it. For anybody that's interested in gears, it's a jumbo. It's a big one. The difference in this, just real quick, like I said, for the gearheads, you've got everything running on the outside. You have this is the water pump down here. This is the generator. Everything runs on the outside of the truck. The valves are located externally on the outside of the heads. These are commonly called jugs. These are your cylinder heads. There are three of them on the truck, and each cylinder head has two pistons in it. So you've got 2, 4, 6 cylinders, and to replace one, it's pretty simple. First of all, you have to take all of this off, but you pull the head right down here and you lift up off of the piston, and that's generally the way you go about redoing your rings or whatever. So I don't want to get too much detail there, but that's a little bit of information.
Thank you.
Some of you might wonder about that. Those engines are unusual. It's what they call a T-head motor. That's what they were commonly called. Just like you have V8s or V6s, that's a T-head. Wooden wheels. I shouldn't say wooden wheels. It's got the rim is steel. The wheel itself is wood, but they are all wood. All these are called fellows.
and they're all hard oak. The second truck is actually my first truck. A quick story here about how I came across this truck. My father and I were going to the National City Stockyards to a farm store to look for something that he needed to repair something at his home. And I took the wrong turn. I ended up behind their fire station. And this truck was sitting back there, and it was totally wrecked. It was a mess. And I looked at my dad, and I said, you know what, I'm going to buy that truck. Because I'd always wanted a fire engine. And anybody that knows me knows it's always been one of my big loves since I was old enough to know what they were. But anyway, make a long story short, I contacted the fire chief that coming Monday and talked to him about purchasing the thing. And he piddled around for about 6 months. And finally, on December 5th, I'll never forget it, I went down. He called me up one morning. It was a hard freeze, just like it is tonight. And he called me up and said, you better come and get it. So my dad and I and my son went and got it. And it was quite comical because there was so much smoke pouring out of the motor because it was dumping all the antifreeze out onto the exhaust manifolds. And my dad said there was more smoke coming out of the back of the truck than there was in the fire. So anyway, we took this truck apart bolt by bolt, piece by piece, completely stripped it down, sandblasted, and painted it, and had all the gold lettering redone on it, the leafing, striping. We rebuilt the motor, my father and I, and my dad actually rebuilt the pump on it right before he passed away. So it's actually in great shape. It runs and pumps just like it's supposed to. It's still functional. And it's kind of my favorite. This is kind of the vintage truck that I would see a lot, and a lot of the guys my age saw a lot when we were kids. I mean, this was a pretty standard piece of fire apparatus for its time. By the way, this is a 1948 American LaFrance, built by the same manufacturer that built the 1922. This is also an American LaFrance. This is a 1939. This is my newest truck. I just bought this truck last spring from a lady in Indiana. The truck originally came from Port Jefferson, New York. The Sawasset Fire Company is who owned the truck. It's in pretty nice shape, runs well. I don't have to do a whole lot to it. It's kind of nice to jump into one that I don't have to do a whole lot of work to. So I'm not quite used to that, but anyway, I don't know this one that well yet. I've got to spend some more time with it. So, this truck and the National City Stockyard truck, going back to the gearheads in the crowd, these are V12 engines. They have dual ignition. In other words, they have everything redundant. The electrical systems are all redundant on them. They were set up that way, you know, back then, because if you had one distributor start acting up on you, the other one would pick up slack and keep the fire apparatus functional. They can be a real terror to tune, but they did do the job with what they were supposed to do. While we're right underneath this stuff, I'll just kind of run through this real fast. Some of the items you see up here on the ceiling, these weird looking pipe looking deals, not the silver one, that's the steam pipe for the building. But the other buildings are the other apparatus are what they call cellar pipes. They would actually knock a hole in the basement floor and stick that the one part of the pipe down in the floor. The other end would be coupled to your hose coming off your pumper or your water source, and they would say flood the basement with that unit where they couldn't get men down in there. They also use these like
where they have piers or, you know, like boardwalks, whatever, say out east, they would use those there also for the same purpose, where they couldn't get underneath, say, the boardwalk. They would knock holes in it, and they would then put this pipe apparatus down in there, and they would go from there as far as fighting the fire. This one over here, this large pipe over here, that one over there is another form of the cellar pipe. That's actually that nozzle that's on there is what they call a distributor nozzle. You see the little holes on there.
On the red one there?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That actually, from water or propulsion, the nozzle itself spins around. And it throws water. It's almost like a gigantic lawn sprinkler, if you will. They use those for years. A lot of fire departments still carry those on their trucks. They're not an everyday item, but you do see them. And it's that way with a lot of the equipment that the older rigs like this may be carrying. Firefighters still use, even though technology has changed so much over the years, they still basically use the same tools because they're going to tear something up. They have to get to where they need to be a lot of times. So some of the barbaric items that you see, like axes and picks and things like that, they're, you know, menacing looking. They still use them to this day.
Like one of these here?
This is what you call a pike pole. Yeah. It has a tip on the end that you can see here. It's got a hook. It's got a point on the end. These were actually used to pull down ceilings in buildings, or they would they could go through, say, a wall, through you know, a wooden wall, or I'm trying to think, drywall, and they would use these. They would knock the hole in it with the tip, pull back on it with the hook, and that's how they would pull them down. They pull down ceilings like this also, tin ceilings. They actually, I don't have one here, I do have one, but they actually had what they call a tin roof cutter that was designed for this, for ceilings and tin roofs that they used to have on buildings. That pipe right there is what they call a ladder pipe. That would be attached to the end of an aerial ladder, where they would raise a ladder, say, to a certain story on a building that was on fire, knock a hole in the window, and then cut loose with the stream through that pipe, or else if they were throwing water for a distance, say on top of a building, heavy volumes of water, they'd set up a number of aerial ladders and use those on there. Nowadays they use platform trucks, things like that, to get the same result. But and nowadays all your nozzles and everything are electronically remote controlled, and whole different animal than what that was, but still the same function. This is kind of a unique piece up here,
yeah,
on the ceiling up here. It's what they call a palm pier ladder. And I think any fireman that knows what that is will tell you that that's last resort. Actually, how that thing works, on the end up here, you see this huge hook. And what these guys would do, if they had no other way to get to an upper story in a building, they got on one end of this thing, they held it up like this. They would hold it up like this, and they'd fling it up and get that hook on a window ledge. Then, if you look at those little steps, and they're only about 6 inches wide, about a foot wide is all that ladder is, they'd climb up that ladder. And like I said, that was last resort. You had to be one heck of a man to even attempt to use one of those things. But they used to be a standard item on New York City fire department trucks. Every truck in the city carried one of those. Now they're kind of a novelty. This one actually came off of Granite City's first ladder truck that was bought in 1922 at the same time the pumpers were bought. So it's been around a long time in this town, along with its buddy over here.
Now, did they come installed like standard on the truck, or did you add accessories? Almost. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Everything is unique to each fire department. One fire department may not fight fire the same way another fire department does.
one fire department may use a certain type of hook on their truck. The fire department down the street might use something else. So it's very unique. It's a very varied profession. I mean, it's whatever the guys like, and it's kind of I sold fire equipment for a while for a living, and I really got to see firsthand how unique and how varied it can be, because it's just, you can throw it all up in the air and it won't come down in the same spot. I mean, it's just, everybody's got a different idea about what they want. And it's been that way since the beginning of time. That's why, like on fire apparatus, they wrote specs, because the chief in Granite City may have wanted a pumper just like this one, same model, same year, same manufacturer, but he didn't want a certain feature that this one's got. He wanted the hose reel instead of on the back step, he wanted it mounted up above the what they call the dunnage area behind the motor. He wanted a closed cab. This guy wants an open cab. So it's each to his own is how that works. Okay.
Can you tell us about this piece behind you here?
This right here is actually a rotary gear pump, which is the identical pump that is mounted on that 1922 American LaFrance. This pump came out of the training academy at St. Louis Fire Department. They had it upstairs for years and years. They were actually going to scrap it, and I was asked, this is a gas can, by the way, that doesn't go on there, but I was asked if I'd like to have it, and I certainly would, or did. But it's kind of unique. You can see on here, they've done cutaways on this, on the unit itself, so that the students, the firefighters who were in training at that point in time, they learned the various parts of the pump, how the pump worked, what the characteristics of it were, little odds and ends, how to make it work when it was that bulky. So it served its purpose for years and years and years over there. They actually had it hooked up to the pump transmission, which is actually what is on the pumper, what drives the pump. And they could actually put this thing in and out of gear during a classroom exercise, and they'd be actually running this pump in order to, give good visuals to the guys. Got an electric motor on it that drives the thing. It's got lights in it, so it would light up. You could see the actual gears in it. Kind of a unique piece. Probably the pump itself is probably close to 100 years old.
Wow.
So it's, like I say, it's been around for a long time.
Yep.
This is the original gas pump that was put in this building when the fire department bought their first motorized piece. Now, I said this piece here was the first piece the city owned when they organized into a paid city fire department. The volunteers that were in here prior to that had a 1916 vintage truck. We only had it for just, I think, 5 years. But this was the pump that I believe they put in here at that point in time to supply their gasoline for that pumper. Now, I'm not certain of that, because it could have been put in when the city organized, when they made this into the regular paid fire department. Because as we've talked before, this firehouse was actually a horse house. There were horses in this house, and actually that was prior to that. So
okay,
it's kind of a conversation piece standing there. I thought it was pretty neat. There are no tanks under here. They were taken out years and years ago, so there's no way that I can stash any gasoline in here or anything like that.
While we're looking at them, are these the original doors?
Those are the original doors. They've seen better days, but they're hanging in there, so that's all I care about at this point in time. this set over here on this side was put in later. These doors that Talon's focusing in on right now, they were put in when the house was built. Strictly for the horse wagons themselves, and then when they motorized and they bought a ladder truck, they added these doors here, So the truck could come in here naturally and park over here where this one pumper is here. The open area you see back in the back there, they knocked a hole, or they knocked that space in that wall to accommodate the long ladders that stuck out the back of the ladder truck.
You're back there now? Yeah.
Where you see the white pumper back here, this area was actually the police department. They actually kept their motorcycles and their apparatus back here. There were cells up here where the jailer could take care of the boys after a good night of drinking. But there's no trace of anything left back here regarding that, other than a lot of etchings in the wall and initials that guys carved up there. And I don't know. I've tried to decipher the story up there, but who knows? It's many years ago, and God only knows. But interesting all the same.
Yeah, you're talking, well, over 100 years
ago. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I've tried, like I said, if the light's right, if you're looking at it right in here, you can actually read some of those. I've tried to do it before, but like I said, it gets kind of, this is all better light.
There's one that says R. Henderson.
Yeah. There's Kobe. I don't know who Kobe was. If you go up further, there's all kinds of writing up high up there.
Huh.
And I've always tried to figure this out because I don't know if they actually had, I was always told that the jail cells were here. So I don't know if they had them on elevated, you know, a platform or how they would have done it. I can't imagine that, but you can see that it's been scratched into all the way to the ceiling. There's all kinds of printing up there.
Huh. Makes you wonder if they had bunk beds.
That's what I've always wondered.
Yeah.
I really thought that maybe that's
yeah.
what it was. Very well could have been. I mean, you see them in movies. Too high, so.
Yep.
Unfortunately, this area back here is not exactly what you would call the well-organized stall of a firehouse, but it still holds its own back here. This truck is a 1949 Mack, which was bought new by the city of Madison. Beautiful gold leaf lettering on the sides of this truck, which is original, and you don't see lettering done like this anymore. This is pretty fancy for its day. This truck was used up until about 10 years ago, I guess, and they retired it, and it's been sitting here, resting here ever since. So that is one of the V12 motors. It is going in a pumper that I am working on. It probably will be spring now, but that's the intention of that motor right there. So that's about 950 cubic inches. It's 275 horsepower. The things that you see hanging in here, they really come from just a real collection of communities and many friends that I've made over the years in the fire service. This coat, for instance, it's seen better days, but this coat belonged to Walmer Schmidtke, who was on the Granite City Fire Department for years and years. And I was given this coat years and years ago. It's been hanging here for I don't know how long now. This helmet's from Collinsville. I've got helmets from Collinsville. This is from QEM, Corey, Elsa, Missouri Valley, I think it is, Mississippi Valley, whatever it is, up by Grafton. This is a Granite City helmet, Fairmont City, Madison. So, and then you've got
a lot of odds and ends, kind of the tools of the trade for the firefighter. These are just different, just a collection of fittings and adapters and gate valves and you name it. These are for foam application to fight like gasoline fires and things like that where foam would be needed. You know, fuel fires, nowadays they use foam for everything, you know, including hay bales and things. Anything they can put foam on, they can smother. Then you have boots. The boots, these came from another Grand City fireman, an old buddy of mine, Skip Markham. Skip is retired and still lives in the county up north, but those were his boots. This is what they call an Indian pack.
Yeah, there's a better view of one over there.
Okay.
Better look at them too. Indian pack, which is very common, commonly used in on rural fire departments. And basically what it is, it holds 5 gallons of water. It has a pump apparatus on it. It has back straps on it. The firefighter puts it across his back, just like a knapsack, and then uses this as his gun. And this is what they walk through, you know, if it's a woodsy area or whatever the case might be, where they can't get a vehicle, this is what they use. You see these a lot, like out west, where they you see the wildfires and whatnot. They use packs similar to that, but they're a different construction now, lighter weight. They're actually fabric now instead of metal. A lot of them are they're fiberglass. They've got all their poly, I should say. They've got all different kinds. Got gas masks. These are very old gas masks. These are not what you want to call real self-contained breathing apparatus, like as they know them nowadays. These were actually NSA's, who is a huge manufacturer of breathing apparatus now. And they did make these, but these were more of a military style. But this is what was used back starting around the 1940s after World War II, because there was so much learned about firefighting during the war. Guys that were on ship, the foam thing that we were talking about over here a while ago, that's really where foam came into being. Was during the Second World War on aircraft carriers with fighter planes landing and on deck, and they used a lot of foam. They called it bean soup at that time. But that's where a lot of this stuff, the technology kind of came from, was military, just like things do nowadays with the military. There's three of those there, and then various fire extinguishers that you'll see here and there. This is a unique piece. This is this actually came out of the Granite City Engineering Depot, the Granite City Army Depot. This was in their headquarters down there, and it actually was the control panel and I'm trying to think of the exact terminology, but it alerted them to where their problems were on the base with different sprinklers in the buildings down there. And when the Army Depot closed up a few years back, I got a call from some of the guys down there that I knew. They asked me if I wanted this, and I told them may as well just bring it down because they were going to throw it in the trash, and I take anything that's going in the trash. So, but anyway, that's where that came from. That's another component to it right there. And then this is also the take-up reel and the register for that system. And the way these work is all your firehouses used to have these years ago. What would happen is, let's just say in the city of St. Louis where they had these on the street corners. You would go up, you had a fire at 2222 Jefferson Avenue,
and you would go pull the box on the corner. The box would send the signal into the central alarm headquarters, and it would actually trip this machine, and it would punch this tape. And if it was box, if let's say it was box 267, from where the alarm was called in, it would punch two holes, then skip, then six holes, then skip, then seven holes. The firefighter would read that, and he would know that was box 267. That's how they detected that back then. It had rolls of paper on it. This is what they call a tape-up reel, take-up reel. This is your register. I've actually got rolls of the paper. You don't see these anymore, not in service anyway. I don't believe there's a city in the United States that still uses them. I might be wrong on that, but I don't think there is. This is another form of gas mask. Like I said, they had, you know, technology's come a long way with all this stuff, is what it comes down to. This is an American LaFrance gas mask, which they're actually made by MSA, the same guys that made those back there. This is my favorite helmet. I've got a number of helmets up there. A number of those are from Granite City. I was given those over the years, but this is my favorite. It's kind of like the old junkyard dog. This is the only leather helmet that I have, that I own. Helmets were commonly made out of leather back then. They made them out of leather, they made them out of aluminum. You can still buy leather helmets every day. They're about $600 for a leather helmet. But I bought this one at a flea market, and the guy said, make me an offer, and I said $20, and it's the best investment I ever made as far as my helmets go. It was a Chicago helmet, or so he said, and I bought it in Chicago, so I believe it was. It's ugly, it's gnarly, but I think it's very unique. So anyway, you can see what happens over the years. They just deteriorate, and this one has seen a lot of activity, a lot of fire. I've had a lot of guys try to buy this from me just because they get a kick out of it like I did. This is a hose roller here. This is another piece of apparatus they used. They would put a rope around that thing, and a firefighter would pull it up onto the roof of the building, or they would carry it with them, either way. And they would put that on the edge of the building around the ledge, and they would then roll the hose so that the hose wasn't going over sharp edges or whatever. They would roll the hose over these rollers and pull it up onto the roof of the building. Very simple apparatus, typical of a lot of fire department stuff, just very simple, just made to do a single job. That's all it was made for. And just practicality.
Who's that up there?
That guy has been up there a long time. I don't know if he's dead or alive. But that guy up there is actually getting ready to slide the pole. And anybody that thinks they're coming into an old fire station, the first thing they're going to ask you is the pole still there? And I've been asked that probably 5,000 times. And yes, the pole is in here. This firehouse actually had two poles at one time. It had one on that end and one on this end. So the firemen upstairs, where the dormitory area was, where they slept, they could, every second counts, as we all know in the fire service. They could either slide down a pole from that end of the building or this end of the building. This pole actually came out of the fire station that is presently used down at 23rd Madison Avenue. They removed poles out of the building down there, and this is one of them. The guys brought it down on top of one of the ladder trucks and delivered it to me. So we put it up, and this firehouse has got a pole again. So whatever happened to the original poles out of here, God only knows. It probably the kick rail in somebody's bar or something is my guess, or
turned in for brass or whatever.
Well, there's a lot of pictures up here on this wall. I know, just out of curiosity, since the one portrait is so prominent, can you tell us who that is?
That is one of the former chiefs. His name was Lige King. Lige was chief back in the 40s, I believe, into the early 50s. I was actually given that picture by one of his nephews. He had it at home, and he had it there for years, and when he found out that I was going to have this place back in 1992, he called me one day and asked me to stop by, and he wanted to give me something. He also gave me these two chairs that are actual 100% authentic firehouse chairs out of this building. So kind of neat that I got those in here. They've been in here, who knows, maybe since 1904. But they came from the same man, Mr. Robertson. And Lige was chief for a lot of years. He was a firefighter. I believe he started in Granite in the 1930s, if I'm not mistaken. And then I've got photos. I've got scads of photos at home, but just some of the ones on the wall here. This picture was taken in 1924 in front of the old post office down on Niedring House, showing the entire fire department at that time, two pumpers, a ladder truck, and a chief's buggy. These two photos here are actually the accident photo of this truck behind us when it rolled in 1928, which we talked about earlier. This is the photo of it as it was rebuilt and re-delivered back to the city of Granite City later on that year. These photos here are of the engine that I mentioned earlier involving the gas pump that was bought by the volunteers prior to the organization of the paid fire department. This is a large fire that was down here. It's dated 4/23 of 1916. I believe it was an old hotel. I cannot recall the name of it, but I do have that information at home. This is the same truck again. This is dated 1916 also. Matter of fact, same date as those photos there. This photo was taken about where, pretty close to where Talon is standing now. Sorry, I'd be on the other side of the truck. I'm mixed up. But against the same wall. This is the wall that we're looking at right now, right here. Here you can see the door frame. Same door frame, as a matter of fact. But that was part of the fire department back then. This was Chief James Marsh. This is Louis Grox. Lou was became chief later on. He was actually the driver of the pumper that flipped over and killed this man, who was John Charbonnier, and he was the assistant chief. This guy here, I'm not sure of who that is right here. I think it may have been a firefighter by the name of Edward Friday. I'm not certain of that, but I think that's who it was. This picture was taken, I believe, in 1904, and they got it dialed up. This is a horse-drawn wagon that the city of Granite City that the volunteers had prior to their gasoline-powered pumper. And this was... they displayed this at the World's Fair in St. Louis in 1904. So that's actually the first piece of fire apparatus that the city had. Interesting piece here. This is basically what they call a deluge set. You can tell by the bore of the nozzle that there's a lot of water that is meant to come out of here, so it took a lot of pumping power behind it to make a stream that size be effective. You can see the size of the pipe, it's huge. These were used in really dire situations where they were just dumping ungodly amounts of water on a fire.
A lot of people call this a fireboat nozzle, which they would have used. This would have been a nozzle that would have been used on a fireboat. It's that large. Talking about technology taking over with a lot of this equipment, I mean, this is, by today's standards, I mean, they've got newer type materials that these are made out of, so much lighter weight. You can get a rig the size of this, or the volume of this, I should say, weighs about 28 pounds. This thing weighs probably 70, 75 pounds. Just heavy, but it did the same purpose, and it could do the same job today if needed. It's again, technology has moved along as times went on with all of the equipment basically that the fire service uses. It's all still doing the same thing. It's fighting fire, it's just that they've made it better, made it easier on the guys as much as possible. Which is good because you have smaller crews nowadays and they have to work harder. So the better the equipment, the better off the guys are. That's what it comes down to. Coat's made out of rubber. This was state of the art back then. Bunker gear nowadays is made out of so many different kinds of materials, fire retardant materials, you name it. They make them out of, they use Kevlar wire or Kevlar material in the manufacture of bunker gear nowadays. It actually has very small microscopic wire in it, which a mesh, which gives the material its strength. So many advancements to help the firefighter to withstand the heat that he has to, and the protection is the name of the game, it turned out here, as it was back then. But back then, everything was different. These guys wore these coats back then more to keep dry than they did to protect themselves from heat. But they didn't do a lot of interior firefighting back then. They did firefighting from the outside, for the most part. So a whole different world back then for the firefighter. Again, going back to the helmets a while ago, here's one made out of aluminum, now they make them out of all kinds of, they make them out of Kevlar, they make them out of fiberglass, or they're made out of all different kinds of materials. So it's a whole different animal with the whole fire service has changed to that degree. It's history, and like I said that night when we were here before, if we don't preserve history, we have no history. So this is just my part. There's guys that I know that some people think, especially my wife, that I've gone overboard and I'm half crazy, which she's right, but I know guys that are crazier than I am. So again, it's just it's how you look at history. Some people don't see a value in it as much as some of the rest of us, and we're the ones, I guess, that the good Lord put on this earth to preserve some of this stuff, so that's what we do.